iOS 17 was just released and there are plenty of new features, but I don't want to focus on the big major features that everyone's already been talking about, like contact posters or standby mode or live voicemail. Instead, I want to focus on new features that are somewhat hidden, maybe barely mentioned in the changelog or not mentioned at all. And a lot of these are just little improvements for convenience that I think are actually just as cool as a lot of the big new features. So let's just jump into it. We can start off with a few new features for the camera app. The first one being a new leveling feature that helps you tell when the camera is completely level to the ground. You can see that it will show like a broken line that will connect when it is level, and also you'll feel a little haptic feedback, just a little vibration when it's level. And you can enable this feature by going into the settings, then camera, and then toggling the level feature on. Also, another little feature for video, you can now have it lock the white balance, which means that it's not gonna change the color temperature while you're filming a video in the middle of it, so it's not gonna make the video more orange or blue, for example. Next, in the Photos app, a new additional way to crop an image is you can simply drag to zoom it, and you'll see a crop button appear at the top right, and when you click it, it will crop to whatever the screen shows, and then you can also continue cropping it more from there. Next, a couple new features for the lock screen. One of them is you can now change the font weight or boldness of the clock letters or numbers, and you can do this by holding down the lock screen, clicking Customize, and then Lock Screen, then tap the clock, and you can just adjust this slider to make it more or less bold. And this will work on any of the fonts for the clock. Next, a nice little thing for wallpapers. If you try to add a picture that doesn't quite fit the screen, whether it's the different aspect ratio or you zoom out too much, now instead of it just being a hard edge where the image stops, it'll show like a blurring to blend more in with the background. And I believe it will use either a black or white blend blur, depending on the brightness of the image. Moving on, we have a few random little new features. One of them being you can now search for certain system settings in the spotlight, like Bluetooth, and it'll actually show the toggle in the results, so you can toggle it right from there. Another feature, actually kind of major one you may have heard before, is that you can now have multiple timers running simultaneously. Finally. Next, the Shake to Undo feature now works when moving around icons on the home screen. So if you make a mistake, maybe move icons and mess them up, you can now just shake the iPhone and it will ask you if you want to undo that movement. So that might be helpful. Next up, in the iCloud keychain where you can store your passwords, you can now add a title to the entries. Before, you could only put the URL and that would show in the list, but now the title will appear whenever you want. Next up, we have a convenient feature for iMessage, specifically being able to choose which iMessage apps actually appear when you click the plus button to show them. You can go to Settings, Messages, and then iMessages Apps, and here you can uncheck ones that are included with normally installed apps, so they won't appear in the list of iMessage apps. And for those, it will not uninstall the actual full app. However, for apps that are purely iMessage apps, like this Game Pigeon one, if you click the minus button on that, it will actually fully uninstall the app. I can also point out for this new interface for bringing up the iMessage apps with this plus icon, you can now actually hold and drag the order of these. So I actually put the Photos one at the bottom because it's closest to where my finger is after I click the plus button. Moving on, we have a few new features for the camera visual lookup feature. So now if you take a picture of laundry symbols, for example, it will show a little analysis icon with a star on the info button and it says look up laundry care, and it can show you what those symbols mean. Similar functionality was also added for car warning lights. So if you take a picture of your dashboard, you'll now see a thing for lookup auto symbol. So you might be able to tell what that means now. And also even for food, if you take a picture of a meal, you're not sure what it is, it should now show lookup food and maybe get an idea of what that thing is. All right, next up we have several new features in Safari. The first one being advanced tracking and fingerprint protection. You can find this under settings, then Safari, and then Advanced. And this just prevents websites from using a lot of other sneaky methods for tracking you that might not be related to cookies. Next, you now have more control over clearing your Safari browsing history. If you go into Settings and then Safari and then Clear History and Website Data, you'll now have multiple options to clear just the last hour, today, today and yesterday, or all history. Also, another new feature in Safari is the option to listen to a page and have it read out the text, and you do this by clicking the double A icon and just clicking listen to page. I believe this only works on websites where the reader mode also would work, so this is mostly for articles. It doesn't necessarily work on every page, but still might come in handy. Also, there are some new widgets for Safari. I don't believe there were any before, and these have to do with the reading list, so you can now put that on your home screen. All right, next up, this one I think is actually pretty huge and only got a tiny little mention in the change notes, and this is gonna make people happy, specifically those who have friends with Android in a group chat. Now, if you have a group chat with both iPhone and Android users, a lot of the iMessage features will work even though there's Android users in there. For example, iPhone users can reply to a message and it will show up properly for other iPhone users using iOS 17 Plus. And for the Android users in there or those on iOS 16, it will just say the usual reply to a message and then whatever text. Also, the iPhone users in a group chat can now edit text and that will show properly, and for those using Android or the old iOS 16 or previous, it will just show as the usual edited to whatever text, like an actual text message. And the same thing is for if an iPhone user uses a reaction to a text, although this actually still shows in iOS 16, so I'm not sure if that might have already been a thing. I will point out though that interactivity between Android and iPhone is still not perfect. For example, if an Android user likes and does a reaction on their side, it'll still send as a text message to the iPhone group chat. But the other way around, at least for latest stock Android, if an iPhone user likes a text, Android will actually show it as a reaction, not a text message. So funny enough, Android can do the conversion, but iPhone won't, and it seems like that might be on purpose. Next, another new feature, if you ever go to change your iPhone's passcode or PIN number, now after you do that, for 3 days, you'll see an option for forgot passcode, where you can actually type in your previous passcode and it will work. Of course, if you don't want to have it do this, there is an option in the settings to have it expire the previous passcode immediately. Next, this one is pretty cool, I think. There are new pens that you can use when marking up a screenshot or picture. Before, there were just three. There was the pen, the marker, which was basically a highlighter, and then the pencil. But now, if you look at the row of pens, you can actually scroll over and see several new ones. But also, there's actually a newer one closer to the left side, this thin-looking pen thing. At first glance, this might look the same as the original pen, but the difference with this one is it does not change its line width. Whereas with the original pen, it would actually get thicker the faster you moved it, whereas this one doesn't, it just stays constant. The new fountain pen looks like this, and I figured out that how it works is basically it makes a thin line unless you're drawing in a downward direction. Then it gets thicker, but if you're drawing horizontally or upwards, it's thin, and I guess it does kind of look like a fountain pen type effect. This new pen here appears to be somewhat of a watercolor effect, hard to describe, but you can just see what it does here. And then there's this other new tool, which I think appears to be a crayon of some kind. I also noticed there's a slight difference in the interface when adding a shape. I'm pretty sure before, if you added a shape by default, it would create an outline, whereas now it adds a solid one. And also the interface looks different in general for how to change the color and stuff. You can just see the difference here. All right, moving on, we have several new cool little features in the weather app specifically. First of all, if you go into what I guess is the details page here, you can now actually scroll to the left and see yesterday's weather. Also, when clicking into this details page, the default is now called conditions, and it still shows temperature, but now also shows several other boxes of info like chance of precipitation and daily comparison, whereas before it was just the temperature. There's also a new little info card about the moon in the weather app. You can see it shows info about illumination, the moonrise, and the next full moon. And if you click into it for more details, you can actually drag this timeline thing and it shows you what the moon will look like at different points in time. I think this is pretty neat. There's also a new card for historical averages. So it'll show how today's temperature compares to the average, for example. You can also see a list of the monthly average temperature ranges for a location, and also for rain. It'll show how the last 30 days has compared to average precipitation. And you can also see a list of monthly averages for rain as well. And also another new little feature is on the map, there is a new overlay for wind speed and direction. So that's kind of cool. And finally, a couple new features for dual SIM users like myself. Now you can have a different ringtone depending on the number that is being called, so maybe you have a work number and a personal number on the same phone, it'll now ring so you know right away which is which. And you can also have it change the vibration pattern as well. And also for dual SIM, if you go to call back an unknown number that's not a contact, you can now choose which SIM card to call from. Whereas before, I think it would always use whatever you had as your default set unless it was an actual contact. So hopefully you found some of these as cool as I did. If you think I missed any, definitely let me know down in the comments, and also check down there because someone might have mentioned one that I didn't. If you enjoyed this video, give it a little tiny thumbs up, not a big thumbs up this time, for the YouTube algorithm, and also maybe consider subscribing. I try to make videos about twice a week, usually Wednesday and Saturday. And if you want to keep watching, I'll post a link to my previous video for new hidden features in iOS 16. Even though that's from last year, you still might not know about a lot of those cool features. You can just click on that right there. So thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.